Hey guys, and welcome back. If you are new here, I am Ashley with Ashley Nicole Photography. I have been a professional photographer for 10 years now. Today, I want to talk about depth of field. This is something that has come up in my previous Photography 101 videos, but I want to go a little bit more in depth with depth of field. So that's what we're talking about today. First of all, what is depth of field? Well, the definition of depth of field is the distance between the closest and farthest objects in a photo that appears acceptably sharp. In other words, the amount of your photo that is in focus. That is the depth of field. So whether you have a small depth of field with a little bit in focus or a large depth of field with a lot of the photo in focus, that is your depth of field. So we're going to talk about what determines the depth of field, how you can use it to your advantage and to get the end results you want. There are three things that affect your depth of field. First is your aperture, and I covered this in the How to Shoot Manual Basics. So your aperture or f-stop determines a few things. It determines how much light is let into your camera, and it also determines your depth of field. A small f-stop or a big opening, so like an f1.4 where your aperture is wide open, lets in a little bit of depth of field. So very, very shallow depth of field. If you have a smaller closed down aperture, f22, f16, f11, you're gonna have more in your depth of field. Here's an example of a wide open aperture and then a closed down aperture. So you have your shallow depth of field and then you have your wider depth of field. The second thing that determines your depth of field, this one is one that most people don't think about until they are shooting professionally, but it's the distance to your subject. The distance from you to your subject affects your depth of field. It affects how much is in focus in that photo. So if I am really close to my subject, my depth of field is going to be smaller. If I am further away from my subject, there will be more in focus in that photo. So if you are really, really close to your subject and you're having a hard time getting everything in focus, scoot back and you will have more depth of field. You can shoot more wide open, but still get everything in focus. And also your distance to the background. A lot of people, almost everyone I shoot, if I want a wall for a background, they automatically like stick their back against the wall. Don't ever put your client all the way against the background. If you want that separation of your subject and your background, you need to move your subject away from the background. The further they are from the background, the more blurry it will be. So let's say here's an example of somebody really, really close to like a tree line. And then if you move them further away, here's what it would look like further away. You will have a nice, creamy, blurred out background. So that is the second one, distance to your subject and to the background. The third thing that affects your depth of field is your focal length. I'm trying to break these down into three separate things so you can understand them separately so you can use them together. So the third one is the focal length. So let's take a 35 millimeter versus a 100 millimeter. Your 35 millimeter from the same distance with the same f-stop is going to have more in focus than your 100 millimeter from the same distance with the same f-stop is going to have a shallower depth of field. That is one reason I personally love shooting with my 100 millimeter macro, is the compression of that lens. If you don't understand focal lengths, I did a video on that as well. I'm kind of doing these in order of things that you need to know and adding on knowledge for you. So if you haven't watched the focal length video, make sure to check that out. But the longer compressed lenses will have a shallower depth of field. So if you add all three of these things together, your aperture, your distance, and your focal length, you can begin to understand and use these to get the photos that you're wanting. I'm going to show you some test shots right here. I'm probably going to use a Dr. Pepper can, haven't taken these yet, but I'm going to show you some test shots of how you can use these three to achieve the photo that you're wanting. The first example is with my 35 millimeter. These are both at f2.8. One of them I am further away from my object and one of them I am much closer. And you will see the plane of focus changes. It gets bigger the further I go away from my subject. You really start to see that when you are with a 100 millimeter lens, because again, that more zoomed in focal length is giving you a shallower depth of field. So if you have your aperture 2.8, you have your 100 millimeter lens, and you're really, really close, your depth of field is gonna be so incredibly tiny. So say I'm doing a ring shot. I'm taking a picture of my ring on some flowers. I have my 100 millimeter lens on, I'm at f2.8, and I get super, super close. The mount that is in focus is so, so tiny, it is important to get that spot on to get the focus you want. If you're not getting enough in focus, you either have to move back or change your aperture. There's an actual formula For depth of field, for just determining how much is in focus. It's very scientific and I don't understand it at all, other than these things affect that depth of field. Does that make sense? So I hope that this helped you understand depth of field just a little bit more. I'm trying to make it as simple as possible so you can, again, understand. So going from my different videos, we have how to shoot in manual. So the relationship between your shutter speed, your ISO, and your aperture. And then your focal length and how that affects a photograph. Now we're talking about depth of field, which ties into both of those. So I'm trying to build on knowledge so you can feel in control of your pictures, feel in control of what you need to change to get the end result that you're looking for. Next video, I'm going to be talking about lighting, how to find the best light no matter what time of day, no matter the conditions. I've already filmed part of it, and the cloudy portion, it was actually raining on us. So I'm going to be looking at lighting in clouds, in full sun, in shade, in spotty light. I'm going to show you how to find the best light no matter what the situation is. That'll be the next video. Be on the lookout for more videos coming soon. If you have any requests, please leave them in the comments below. I am currently connecting with other photographers in my area to do some fun challenges. I have possibly an ugly location challenge coming soon. Super excited for that. I'm so excited to meet other photographers in the area. So I hope that you enjoyed this video. If you did, please give it a thumbs up. And if you haven't already, please hit that subscribe button down below. Really, really helps me out. All right, guys, I will see you guys next time. Bye. I feel like I'm not breathing while I'm talking. I'm just talking about it. I hope this is making sense. I feel like I'm shouting at you. The third thring, a shallower. I'm not really sure what else to say now.